markers, genetic markers. His lecture is evidence-based markers and an algorithm for treatment of depression. Thank you very much, Avatar.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here and being the last day of this meeting. So we keep my promise. Yesterday afternoon we discussed about the treatment, how difficult is treatment for depressed patients, how difficult it is to choose, how difficult it is to treatment resistant depression. And I just make the one comment, I just show you one slide about how the future could help us. I told you that we have many difficulties, many challenges, difficult to treat patients, difficult to choose the right drug for each patient. Individualization is the word. Individualization that we use now from a clinical point of view. But now I can show you that individualization can go much beyond, much further. Individualization can go exactly to the real biological substrate of the patient. And this will have a big impact in our clinical practice. During this presentation, I will try to give you an overview, which is the current status, and which are the perspectives of this field. So, starting where we left you yesterday, the predictors of how a patient can go, the predictors of outcome from a clinical point of view, are some. You remember yesterday I told you that some specific predictors are present, like, for example, higher education, good income, social support. These are predictors, but these are general predictors, broad predictors, like we studied in the study sample. You can have some kind of prediction, but you don't have suggestions. You don't have specific indications. You can have a broad prediction if a patient will be more resistant than another. But then what to do? Then we have to apply the clinical criteria we discussed yesterday. But there is something more. Something more that is linked to the genetic background of the patient. And this is starting already to be applied in reality. This is FDA. FDA already has some indications about how to use genetics in treatment of patients. A lot of indication comes from oncology, where many drugs must be prescribed after the genetic screening to be sure that the drug is the most effective and the less dangerous for the specific patient. But also in psychiatry, there are a couple of examples like carbamazepine and for pharmacokinetic or antipsychotics that is already in the drug label. And if it is in the drug label, then we must be very careful, because if we don't follow those directions, we are out of the law. So, it is already there some kind of indication. If you use carbamazepine in a subgroup of Asian patients, they have a higher risk of reaction, skin reaction. And if you don't consider this from a genetic point of view, you could be liable for any damage that the patient can have. So this is just a first small but practical example that genetics should be routinely used in our patients. But we can go much beyond this, not just considering the poor metabolizing status of the liver enzyme. This is something quite simple. If a patient has a liver that is working less than normal, obviously the patient will have higher drug levels and therefore possible toxicity. This is a quite simple, straightforward strategy that could be used now. But I want to go a little bit beyond it, to another step, not just the mechanism by liver metabolism, but to the brain and to the target of these drugs. And so the question is now, which are the genes involved in other mechanisms that are not the liver? The mechanisms are so many. If you consider that when you prescribe an antidepressant or an antipsychotic to a patient, obviously first passes through the liver, and therefore the liver is important if it is working or not, depending on the metabolizing status. But then after, cluster, there are a lot of other targets that are controlled by genes. So it depends if the blood-brain barrier, remember I told you yesterday, blood-brain barrier, in some patients the blood-brain barrier is not so easy to pass compared to other patients. Or even if you pass the blood-brain barrier, when the serotonin reuptake inhibitors goes to the transporter, that is the natural target, it depends if the transporter is able to feel the effect of the serotonin transporter inhibitor or not. All those targets are very important because all of them are controlled by genetic variants and they are different from one person to another. So this would explain a large part of the variance of what we see in our patients. Why some patients don't respond? Many are the reasons. They don't respond because the liver is too active and so the plasma level is too low. The solution is very easy. Increase the plasma level, increase the dose. Patient cannot respond because the blood-brain barrier is closed. And then what? Or you increase the drug or you change the drug. Or the patient could not respond because the serotonin transporter in the brain is not functioning properly. Then what? Again, or increase the dose or change the drug. But you don't know this because this is hidden inside the patient. And this was pharmacogenetic utility. Pharmacogenetic can let you see what you don't see in a way that you can decide your treatment in a much wiser way. Saying that, let's go a little bit into detail. Which are the genes and mechanisms that can influence the person's response? This was the first, this is now a kind of historical slide, the famous serotonin transporter. It was about more than 15 years ago, it was 97, when I remember we in Milan were thinking about this possibility. And I remember, like it was yesterday, I was in the underground of the hospital looking at the data in an old computer, 15 years, 20 years old computer, and I got this. This is a historical slide also. I got this, and I was very surprised at this. I said, wow, but here there is a difference. Here there is something. At that time, nobody was thinking that genes would influence antidepressant response. It was a completely new field. And then I realized, I said, look, but these patients that have a short variant, they don't respond very well to antidepressants compared to the other variants. There is a big difference. So what? And then we published the first paper, and then the second, and then we studied again. And then year passes, year after year. And after about 15 years, we did a meta-analysis, and the results, even if not 100%, have been confirmed. We now have something like 30-40 papers about serotonin transport gene variant, and the large majority of them are confirming that there is one variant, short variant, that is predicting a poor response to antidepressants. And this, despite some other papers that don't confirm this, but we'll discuss later the discrepancy between evidence. This discrepancy and this effect is not a very simple one. At the beginning, we were a little bit naive. We thought, okay, it's very simple. We have one gene variant that reduces the serotonin transporter in the synapses. Therefore, the drug has less substrate to work on. This was very simple, very linear. But reality was a little bit more complicated. This is not the case. It's not a question of number of serotonin transporter in the brain. It's a question of plasticity of the brain. Because those people with short variants, they are born and live with a reduced number of serotonin transporter in the brain. And this leads their serotonin system to be less flexible. And this reduced flexibility is influencing a wide range of activities that we summarize in this paper and another one that we are completing just now. These people with just one gene variant in the serotonin transporter, they have problems in terms of hippocampal volume that is linked with depression, as you know, with amygdala activity. activity that is linked with anxiety, as you know, with anxiety traits in others, and many other features, including the risk of developing depression and bipolar, and also how they react to stress. So there is evidence out there very clear that creates one of the most clear at the moment landscape of the whole genetic field, and in particular of pharmacogenetic, that one single gene variant in the serotonin transporter can lead to a cascade of events that, starting from anatomical changes in those patients, leads to temperamental changes, more anxious, more reactive. And this high reactivity leads to a more sensitive to stressors. So these people are extremely sensitive to any kind of negative stress they receive. After this, they have a higher risk to develop mood disorders. And if they develop mood disorder, they have a reduced response to antidepressants. And this is due to an overall poor serotonin pathway plasticity. So I went a little bit in detail in one of the genes because it is very useful to let you know and explain and show which is the real effect of genetics in antidepressant response. So forget the idea that there is one gene that is responsible of antidepressant response. No. One gene is responsible of a cascade of effects that eventually some patient is linked with antidepressant response. One gene changing the brain structure, the brain functioning, the clinical picture, and then the end, the response, because of the poor plasticity, and so antidepressants have difficulties in reshaping the function of this brain. But a question that I always receive in congresses like this is that people ask me, then why? How is it possible that there is such a variant that is leading to such an unfavorable outcome in these patients? More anxious temperament, less flexibility, and all those problems. Why? Evolutionarily, we should be fitting to the environment. Exactly, this is the answer. This is a variant that is making us fit to the environment in terms that the environment is not always the same. So people with this variant is fitting the environment much better if the environment is very calm, if the environment is safe. If the environment is safe, those people perform better. And our colleague, Gianno Saro, demonstrated very well in this paper that people with the short variant, the one that has no flexibility, people with the short variant, they can have higher educational attainment. We demonstrated that they have higher social adjustment. And the other evidence from parallel studies demonstrated that they can have also big effects. So you have to imagine that genetic is not good or bad. Genetic is a modulation strategy for the human race. So genetic created two serotonin transporter style, a flexible serotonin transporter style to adapt to exceptional circumstances very well, and a stable serotonin system to adapt to very stable situations. And so depending on how you live in, you will be favored or unfavored, depending which is your structure. And this is very clear also from the original Caspi paper, where you see that people with the short variant of the serotonin transporter have problem in case of stresses, but in absence of stresses, they perform better. So this makes you understand how it's complex to make a prediction based on simply genetics. You need to consider environment, you need to consider a lot of other features, because otherwise, genes alone are not sufficient. It's not like I have antibiotics and pneumonia, it's very simple, bacteria, pneumonia, antibiotics, and the patient is cured. I went into detail of the serotonin transporter, but don't worry, I will not put such a detail for the disease, just to understand the idea. Other than the serotonin transporter, of course, there are a number of genes that are involved in the serotonin pathway, and not only the serotonin pathway, all the pathways that are linked to antidepressant response. I will not go into detail all of them, but the serotonin transporter is one that has been studied by 71 papers, and then 15, 20, many other systems of the serotonin system, or enzymes, many other systems, because antidepressants have a cascade of effects from serotonin transporter blockade to many others. And not on antidepressants are serotoninergic, so also adrenaline, dopamine, and so on. So this is the landscape of the genes that influence somehow antidepressant response. Until here it is theory. Let's try to go into practice, that is the second part of the presentation. Practice is difficult because as a serotonin transporter, as you have seen, is responsible for a wide range of effects, it is the same also for the other genes. Consider, for example, the famous COMT that is influencing tension, in anxiety, in schizophrenia, in bipolar, in depression. Consider also the famous, let's say, the IV that is influencing many attentional aspects. Or the DAOA that is influencing aspects in bipolar and schizophrenia. So many of the genes that we are discussing, starting from the serotonin transporter, have a pleiotropic-wide effect in many disorders. So it's difficult to put all these things together in an easy list for the clinician. But let's not worry, because there is a possible solution. Some people, three groups in the world, try to make a whole genome study to uncover all the possible variations, to put them together, because we started from serotonin transporter, we went on with the pH, C proteins, and so on. And then a group from US, a group from Europe, and a group from UK put together all the genes and they tried to do a very large analysis. Results were not very enthusiastic, because putting all of them together, no results were so strong to be significant above this line. I was not surprised of this, because antidepressant response is not a monogenic, mono-SNP disease. It is impossible to find a peak here, because the effect is due to many, many genes, just here in some chromosomes at different level, that all of them do something in a complex way. So this is why it's not possible to use traditional analysis in antidepressant response genetics. And this is why our group tried to focus on specific aspects. In this case, for example, we identified one signal where looking at early response. Probably, if you look at the glutamatergic system in early response, you can have a signal, because glutamate, as you know, the ketamine story, glutamate could be the system related to early response. Could be, this is an hypothesis because this is only one paper. Or in this other paper, we focused on non-fact, always focusing on the study American sample. If the quality of life is somehow modulating the effect of the SNP, and we show an modulating effect of quality of life on the SNPs. Just two examples to show you that you should consider many aspects together, not just all genes. We know that the environment is important. We know that support is important. We know that clinical presentation is important, that this compound is different. So we have to integrate all this information together when we want to get the prediction. And so, it is possible to use it in everyday clinical practice. The last five, six slides of my presentation are the most important part of the presentation, because it's what you will see probably in the next year or now. This was the dream a few years ago, to go to the chemist with your DNA to ask for a specific drug. We are getting close to this. For example, this would be a very lucky situation. But unfortunately, it is very rare. In this patient, there was a problem, a missing area in chromosome 15, that gave him epilepsy, intellectual impairment, psychosis, and aggression. Strange clinical picture, difficult to control with carbamazepine, valproate, or antipsychotics. Well, they discovered that it was due to a specific alpha-7 nicotinic cholinergic receptor. And then they simply treated him with a solution of this deficit, perantamine. And the patient improved completely. So, this is a very simple example, but not all our patients are like this. If our patients would be similar, we should understand what is missing and we would replace what is missing. But it's not always so simple. I just wanted to show this because it's a poor example of pharmacogenetic applied in clinic. But it's rare. It's rare why? Because every polymorphism is explaining a low variance, a low effect. Serotonin transporter, short variant, changes to 3-5%. And all the other polymorphisms similar, because a lot of other variables influence drug response, environment, social support, hormonal status, and so on. And then the genetic situation is complicated with new mutations arising, there are interactions, and so on. And then drug response may differ across episodes. So there are a lot of confounding factors. So how to work with this? What with this? With a comprehensive view. In this paper, I had a lot of difficulties in publishing this paper because it was not understood by any of the reviewers. I just published two clinical cases because I wanted to demonstrate that two measured depressive patients can have two different, completely different outcomes depending on their clinical situation. Looking at what? Personality, temperament, defense mechanism, self-esteem, IQ, social adjustment, and one of them was an engineer, clever, with family, similar depression, but he had a very good outcome. The woman, on the opposite, poor outcome, because on this aspect, they were very different. So the reason why I wanted to publish this paper is to demonstrate that clinical demographic factors have a deep impact in depression. If you don't use this, genetic will be highly biased. And just for fun, one of the reviewers was rejecting this paper because told me, well, two cases is not a sufficient sample size to publish a paper. This was it. However, after this, we try to understand how is the money that we can get if we use genetic testing in advance. And the money that we can get is a lot, because once we can decrease the time patients stay depressed, we will save a lot of money in terms of health system. But in the last 2 minutes, I want to go into specific detail of how this is performed. This is an example taken by oncology. In oncology, they have a solution. They calculate a number of genes. If you have many genes that are negative, like this area, then you will have a very high risk of cancer. If you have many protective genes, you have low risk of cancer. This is the perfect tool for genetic application. Let's see what there is in psychiatry. In psychiatry, there are many companies that are working on this field. Some are good, some are less, depending on how they work. But a prediction algorithm, in my opinion, should be a prediction that is based on genetic variants, on biomarkers, on clinical features, and on patient needs. So it is a combination of all what I told you this training. Starting from biomarkers, biomarkers is what you have in the blood. So, growth factors like BDNF, that is very important, inflammatory indications, interleukin 6, 2, and so on. And those are markers that give you an idea of the status of the patient. That are what is the patient is in the blood now, not genetic, that is something that comes from the patient was born. This is an important point, but this is the central slide of all my presentation. Not the final, because I have another two or three, but this is, let's say, the most important. These authors, that unfortunately are out of paper for money, they try to do what is the future. They take a set of genes, pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic, and they look at their genes, and they create a composite phenotype for each drug, for each compound. And so this is what you get. This is the sheet that you will receive from this analysis. You have your patient, Mr. John Smith, that comes to you with depression. You take some saliva, put the saliva in a box, give the box to the laboratory. 2 days later, you receive this. And this tells you, okay, how can I behave with this patient? Considering his genetic background, I suggest you to use most. There's venlafaxine. Selegiline, if you want to use an antidepressant. Ketamine, antiprazidone, if you want to use an antipsychotic. A little bit careful with this list. Generally, try to avoid this other list. Why avoid? Because any of these, in this specific genetic background, gives some kind of problem. For example, maybe with this genetic background, bupropion is giving more anxiety. With this genetic background, amitriptyline will give interaction with something else. And for different reasons, those ones are a little bit to be used with caution. Not avoid it, but be careful. And this, I think, is of a tremendous utility for us. And this is exactly what I was expecting, not genetic telling you, oh, you have to use centrally. No, this is not possible. Genetic cannot be so deterministic, but give you probabilities. And what happens in a practical trial if you follow these rules or don't follow these rules? It's fascinating. If you follow these rules, you have benefits in terms of healthcare visit compared if you don't do it, in medical visit compared if you don't do it, in medical absence from work, a lot, and in total spending. So you have benefit if you follow this strategy. As I show you in our previous paper, it's mathematically demonstrated that if you follow the genetic advice, you have benefit for your patient and for the community. So let's go to the end. This has been developed by many groups. One in particular is Gilside. I don't make any advertisement for them because I'm not connected with them. They sell one of these products, but many other companies are there. And they also replicated a benefit that you use the prediction compared if you don't use the prediction. And this is the last prediction I want to tell you because the prediction is not based only on the 5-6 genes that I showed you with GenSight. There is also other possibilities. For example, this is the blood-brain barrier that I told you. If you use the blood-brain barrier prediction, you know that for some patients, the blood-brain barrier is more stiff and drugs don't pass. And then what you have to do? You may increase the substrate and you have a benefit. You can switch to another drug, not such a benefit. Switch to a completely another antidepressant, some benefits. So, in this paper, it was demonstrated that patients who received the blood-brain barrier genotyping had higher remission rates because clinicians started to use remedies to this problem. They knew that the patient had the blood-brain barrier not working, so they added, increased the dose of change drug, and patients stayed well. So, we are almost in time. What I would like you to remember from this presentation. First, prediction of antidepressant response using clinical factor that we do now is not sufficient. And the choice of drug, as I explained to you from a clinical point of view, is useful can lead to benefit, but is not perfect. Things could much improve once we add, not substitute, to the clinical information we discussed yesterday about weight gain, sexual dysfunction, choice of the best drug, and then we will combine together with the genetic predictor. This is feasible, this is easy, and I can tell you here for the first time in the world, because we decided very few days ago, that we are trying to develop a software algorithm, probably we'll make also an app that you can easily use in inserting information and having the suggestion of the best drug. Thank you for attention.
Some questions, I'm sure. Can I say in advance that we have are not applying strict rules of timing to Alexandra or